हेलो गाइस, हाउ आर यू। सो इन टुडेज सेशन वी आर गोइंग टू टॉक अबाउट लाइब्रेरीज, द लाइब्रेरीज विच यू आर गोइंग टू यूज इन डेटा साइंस, डेटा एनालिटिक्स, मशीन लर्निंग, डीप लर्निंग एंड आर्टिफिशियल इंटेलिजेंस। सो हेयर आर मेनी लाइब्रेरीज विच वी कैन यूज इन दीज डोमेन्स। देयर आर अबंडेंट ऑफ लाइब्रेरीज, बट हेयर इन दिस सेशन वी आर गोइंग टू टॉक अबाउट सम पॉपुलर लाइब्रेरीज, सम इम्पॉर्टेंट लाइब्रेरीज फॉर अ बिगनर। Which these libraries are important that every beginner should have to go through from these libraries, should have some understanding about these libraries. And many beginners, I can say like most of the beginners, make their basics very strong by using these libraries in these domains. So let's get started. Here in this session, I'm going to talk about NumPy, Pandas, Matplotlib, Scikit-learn, Keras, TensorFlow, PyTorch. So here are 7 libraries which we are going to talk about in this session. But as I can said earlier, here are abundant of libraries in these domain. So by starting with NumPy, NumPy is a Python library used for working with arrays. It also has functions for which in domain of linear algebra, Fourier transform and matrices. So basically I can say that NumPy is that library which we used for making NumPy arrays. Like in Python, arrays are taking much time. The Python basics array, the Python arrays which are already built in. But if we make arrays by using the NumPy library, they are much faster, because as you see here, NumPy is a Python library and is written partially in Python, but most of the parts that require fast computation are written in C or C++. So as you see here, most of the part that requires most of the computation power, or you can say which require the fast computation, are written in C and C++. That's why NumPy arrays are faster, because most of its components, most of the code is written in C and C++. That's why NumPy is much faster than the normal Python arrays. So that's why we are going to use NumPy arrays in our Python code, so that we can decrease our code time and decrease our overall time. And it has functions for working in domains of linear algebra, Fourier transform and matrices, as NumPy is basically used for mathematical operations. If you want to use mathematical operations like dot product, cross product, making matrices, doing linear algebra, doing Fourier transform, but for doing these all mathematical operations, we gonna use NumPy library. It is very convenient to use this, so that we can implement all these mathematical equations. And as you all know, these domains were basically built on mathematics. That's why for implementing these mathematics equations, we're gonna use this NumPy library. NumPy was created in 2005 by Travis Oliphant. It is an open source project and you can use it freely. So as you see, NumPy library is open source. You can install this NumPy library in your system and you can use this freely. There is no cost for that. And NumPy stands for numerical Python, obviously self-descriptive, that for doing the numerical operations, for doing the mathematical operations, we're gonna use this NumPy library. That's why they name this library as numerical Python, or in short, you can say NumPy. After this, we are going to our next library, which is Pandas. Pandas is an open source BSD licensed Python library providing high performance, easy to use data structures and data analysis tools for the Python programming language. So Pandas is the library which we are going to use to do some data structure, to do some data analysis. If we have some data in our file, like we have JSON file, we have Excel file, or you can say any format file, to load that data in our Python code and to do some operations on that Python code, and also to view some of the data from that whole data and to execute some operations on that data. Like if you have abundant of data and you want to see the data set, and you can say you want to see the data which comes under the specific date or which comes under the specific range or any criteria, for applying that criteria, we use the Pandas libraries. And also to to load that data in our Python file, we use pandas library. It is very convenient to use, and it is basically made for doing these operations. And as we have the work on data sets, like in these domains, we have to work on abundant of data. So for working on data and so implementing functions on that data set, we have to load that data set. We have to go through from that data sets. That's why these panda libraries is very important for us. Python with pandas is used in wide range of fields, including academic and commercial domains, including finance, economics, statistics, analytics, etc. In this tutorial, we learn the various features of Python, pandas, and how to use them in practice. This part we're gonna do while we are doing some code. That time I will show you how we can use various features of Python pandas library. And as you can see here, pandas library is, you can say, used in very, very vast various fields, like finance. In finance, we have abundant of data set to load that data set, to see that data set and to do some changes, to extract some data. We use pandas libraries in Python. And also in economics, we have abundant of data sets. To load that data sets, we use pandas. In statistics, also I can say that in statistics we have data sets like x-axis, y-axis, the coordinates for all that. We have the pandas library to load that data and to view that data. In analytics, to see the data, to load the data, we use pandas. So here in finance, economics, statistics, analytics, and in other domains also where we have to work on data, we use pandas library in Python. Then comes matplotlib. Matplotlib is a plotting library for Python programming language, and it's numerical mathematics extension NumPy. So by seeing this, it is self-descriptive. Like, matplotlib is that library where we gonna use in Python so that we can plot some graphs, charts, to plotting something on our screen, to plot something and to show our data, to visualize our data. We use matplotlib library so that we can easily visualize our data, to see how is our data is going and what is the nature of our data. We use this matplotlib library for the visualization. And as you can all see that when we provide data to this matplotlib, it has to perform some mathematical operations in backend. So that's why it used this NumPy library for doing these operations. It also provides an object-oriented API for embedding plots into applications using general purpose UI toolkits like tkinter, wxpython, qt, and gtk+. So here line wants to say that this matplotlib API for plotting the graphs and charts and for showing the all other plots, it uses the GUI applications. As you know or don't know, then I will tell you that for doing the GUI purpose, like for making the graphical user interface, we use tkinter, or we can use wxpython, or we can use qt or gtk+. These are the libraries in Python for which we can use for making the GUI. Like in tkinter, you make GUI for applications, and here in wxpython, in qt means pyqt. You can search on web also, like pyqt4, pyqt5, and there are many versions of pyqt and these libraries also, and also gtk+. These libraries in Python were used to show to make the GUI, graphical user interface. And in matplotlib, we have to show and visualize our data, and visualize in the sense I can say that we have to visualize our data in a beautiful manner. Like, though I don't want some lines and only lines and numbers on my graphs, I want some visualization on that graph, like what these lines significant for, what these line is for, and like in a line graph, we have two lines. Then I have to mention the legend, like this line is mentioning the graph of this data set and this line mentioning the graph of this data set. For doing that, for showing some useful information, this Matplotlib uses the GUI toolkits like tkinter, wxpython, Qt, or GTK+. There is also a procedure PyLab interface based on a state machine like OpenGL designed to closely resemble that of MATLAB. Through it, use is discouraged. As you can see, like there is a procedure PyLab interface based on a state machine. Like it is closely, it is like very much similar to the MATLAB, as you know or may not know. MATLAB is also used for showing the graphs and also used for visualization tasks. So it is very similar. Matplotlib is very similar to that, or you can say closely resembled to that MATLAB. Then after this library, we are going to see our scikit-learn library. Scikit-learn is a free software machine learning library for the Python programming languages. For doing the machine learning task and for applying the algorithm and to train some models, to make some models, we're going to use this scikit-learn library in our Python programming languages. It features various classification, regression, and clustering algorithms, including support vector machines, random forest, gradient boosting, k-means, and depth scan, and is designed to interoperate with the Python numerical and scientific libraries NumPy and SciPy. So here it want to say that the scikit-learn has various algorithms like classification algorithm, regression, and clustering algorithms. These algorithms scikit-learn have and many more. And in classification algorithm, it has specifically like support vector machine, random forest, and other libraries also. And for regression, it has linear regression and polynomial regression library. And also for clustering algorithms, it has k-means clustering and many more libraries. So here are some algorithms were mentioned. Actually, I'm sorry if I said library for these random forest gradient boosting, but these are algorithms. So sorry for that. But here, these are the three basic types of algorithm: classification, regression, and clustering algorithms. And for classification, there are many libraries. And that all, and you can say many of those classification library were in scikit-learn, and also same for regression and clustering algorithms. So scikit-learn is basic library when you are going to start with machine learning and deep learning. For doing the machine learning, first you go through the scikit-learn library to get to know about the machine learning models and how they work and how to parse our data set and how to organize our data set in such a way so that we can provide our data set to the machine learning models, and how to test our machine learning models. So for doing all those things, we use the scikit-learn library to get to clear about our basics, get to know about the basics, and build our basics in this field. Then comes, after this library, we have Keras library. Keras is an open source library that provides a Python interface for artificial neural networks. Keras acts as an interface for the TensorFlow library. So here, Keras comes after the scikit-learn. Like in scikit-learn, you make some machine learning models. But when we have abundant of data sets, when we have many dimensions of data sets, like when the scikit-learn fails to make a good machine learning model, then we have go to in next state, which is deep learning. And for deep learning, we have Keras library, and from this Keras library, we can do our both machine learning and deep learning work. That means we can do work on small data sets and also do work on larger data sets, doing work on small dimensions data sets, doing work on large dimension of data set. So Keras library basically used to make artificial neural networks, used to do many algorithms, like if you want to implement some algorithms of neural networks, then this Keras library is used for making those neural network algorithm, and Keras act as an interface for TensorFlow library. Here it means that basically first TensorFlow library is came, and the TensorFlow library to code on that, it is very difficult, because it is not that much difficult, but for learning that all those things and all those commands, and to even do, for doing a small code, you have to write much. Even if you want to do a small task, you write much things, and you have to implement many things in TensorFlow. So get to read about it, and to write the code in less, to write whole code, to done the whole task in less number of codes. Francis Cloyte, the maker of this Keras library, make this library so that he don't want to write a much larger code for doing a small task. He can just make some 2-3 lines of code for implementing some algorithm by using this Keras library. So here in backend, our TensorFlow library is working for doing the machine learning and deep learning task, but the TensorFlow code, we don't write the TensorFlow code, we write the Keras code, and that will convert into the TensorFlow. Means the Keras code will use the TensorFlow library and just work on the top of the TensorFlow library. It's like an abstraction layer, as you all know about abstraction. Like in the abstraction, the TensorFlow code is hidden, and you just want to write about, you just want to take care of or take care about of this Keras code. After that, we come like this, come up with up until version 2.3, Keras supported multiple backends, including TensorFlow, Microsoft Cognitive Toolkit, R, Theano, and PaidML. So here I like tell you, like Keras is working on the above of TensorFlow library. Like you don't want to take care about much things in TensorFlow, like you do in TensorFlow. Like while writing the code in TensorFlow library, you have to take care about many, many things. But in Keras, you don't care about those all things. And Keras is just, you just think about small things and you can do your code. So like that, you can code on Keras library, but in backend, you can use other libraries also. If you don't want to use TensorFlow, like you don't like this TensorFlow library and don't like the work of this TensorFlow library, but you want to code on Keras as you do, so you can change your backend to Microsoft Cognitive Toolkit, or you can change your backend to R or Theano or PlaidML. So these are all libraries were supported in Keras. You can use any backends, but most of the times we use this TensorFlow library in our backend. But if you want, you can use Microsoft Cognitive Toolkit, R, Theano, or PlaidML, or if there are many other libraries were came that were supported by Keras, you can use that library also. Then point come is designed to enable fast experimentation with deep neural networks. It focuses on being user friendly, modular, and extensible. So as I said, for writing a simple code, for doing a small task or a simple task, you have to take care of many things while writing code in TensorFlow. Okay, but here in Keras, the main task, the main motivation of making this Keras library is the user friendly. Then that means that anyone, any user can came and write the code about these deep neural network, can make these deep neural network, can implement all those deep neural network algorithm. So for doing that purpose, and so make that purpose so easy, to make it more user friendly, this Keras library is made. And after that, it was developed as a part of the research effort of project ONEIROS, open-ended neuro-electronic intelligent robot operating system. And its primary author and maintainer is Francois Cloyte, a Google engineer. So as I said earlier, Francis Clouet make this library for his own work. Like he don't want to write the much coding TensorFlow. But after that, he may think to make it a big project, and after that he make this a big project of this research, and he make this project of open source. We all community thanks for this person Francis Clouet, that many, or I can say like 90% of persons who came in this domain is just because of this Francis Clouet, because he made deep learning so easy that anyone can implement deep learning algorithms. But if we don't have this deep learning algorithm, deep learning library Keras, then you can say like 90% of people won't came in this domain. So right now he's a Google engineer. You can search that. Then after comes the TensorFlow library. TensorFlow is a free and open source software library for machine learning. It can be used across a range of tasks, but has a particular focus on training and inference of deep neural networks. So TensorFlow is, as you all know, TensorFlow is free and open source. Anyone can download it. Anyone can install it on their system and use for doing stuff on machine learning, or you can select deep learning. So for making the deep neural networks, basically, first we use the TensorFlow in past, but as I said earlier, Keras is king. But here we are going to talk about TensorFlow for its advantages and disadvantages. So TensorFlow is basically made to be so that we can implement deep neural network. Like if some theory games, like if we can make some machine who can think on its own, but for that we don't implement anything. Then came some functions and all. So to implement those functions and to wrap up all those functions, we make Google make a library that's called the TensorFlow. Here in TensorFlow, you can make the deep neural networks or make the neural networks and any other algorithms and implement those. So next comes the TensorFlow is a symbolic math library based on data flow and differentiable programming. It is used for both research and production and at Google. So here as the TensorFlow is make, TensorFlow is totally based on the math. It is totally based on mathematics to doing some operations, to do the addition, to solve an equation, to perform an equation. And it uses, as you can see, the math, and to solve those mathematical equations, TensorFlow use the data flow, or you can say TensorFlow make some graphs and do the differential, make the differential graphs from those mathematical equations, and separate those mathematical graphs and separate those differentiable graphs, and by solving each graphs they combine all the answers, and at the end they get the answer of those equations. So TensorFlow is totally based on math, and to solve those mathematical equations, TensorFlow use the differentiable programming. Differentiable programming means they make the differentiable graphs, they divide those graphs, and they combine the answers of those graphs and get the in total at the end answer. So TensorFlow is used for both research and production at Google. So if Google make any deep neural network or Google make any machine learning model, then it is obvious that Google uses its own library, that is TensorFlow. And if Google making something new, then we can say that at the back end, Google uses this TensorFlow library. And for doing the research process, Google uses the TensorFlow library. So that's all for TensorFlow. Next comes the PyTorch. PyTorch is an open source machine learning library based on the Torch library, used for applications such as computer vision and natural language processing, primarily developed by Facebook's AI research lab. So after TensorFlow, here comes the second library, which is PyTorch. PyTorch is basically separates from the TensorFlow. It's not like the Keras, which is built on above the TensorFlow. PyTorch is a own independent library, which used his own work, which used his own calculations and some operations to do the calculations and to make the deep neural network. As I said, make the deep neural network means PyTorch is also used for used in deep learning and to implement some neural network algorithms. And this PyTorch library is basically developed by Facebook, and it is an open source machine learning library. Anyone can install on their system this PyTorch and use as they want. It is free and open source software. As I said earlier, it is open for everyone, released under the modified BSD license. This is the type of license under which this PyTorch library is released. Although the Python interface is more polished and the primarily focus on development. So basically this PyTorch is make the on the motivation that we have to develop something new. Like if we have to develop something new, good, and which is used to reduce the work of human and for innovation, the by just taking care of all these things, by taking these as a motivation, this Facebook AI research lab make this PyTorch library. So that's all for today's session. Like that's all libraries we talk in our session. These seven libraries: NumPy, Pandas, Matplotlib, Scikit-learn, Keras, TensorFlow, PyTorch. I give you some basic introduction and I'm going to use these library furthermore, but I want that you all just go through these library more and more and try to implement these libraries on your own. First, I want you that before coding, you should also try to write some code in these NumPy, Pandas, Matplotlib, Scikit-learn, Keras, TensorFlow, and PyTorch. Try to get familiar with this so that you can at least get to know why we are importing, why we are using these libraries in our code. And if we are using these libraries, then what operations we can possibly perform or what operations possibly we are going to do. Like if I import this NumPy library, then you make intuition like in our code, we are going to do some mathematical operations. If I am using the Scikit-learn library, then you can instantly make some intuition like we are going to make a machine learning model, and so that we are going to use this Scikit-learn library. If I'm using the Keras, TensorFlow, or PyTorch library, then you have to make an intuition like, okay, in this code, in this task, we are going to implement some neural network algorithm. Or you can say Panda. If I write Pandas, then you can simply say that we are going to implement, we are going to load and deal with the data. And if we are going to, if I use this Matplotlib library, then you're just get an intuition like we are going to visualize our data. We have to see the graphs and we have to see the plots. That's why I'm going to use this Matplotlib library. So try to research about these library more and more. And here I am. And if you get stuck anywhere, then I'm going to tell you. And furthermore, I am going to implement these library. So don't take any tension. Don't be panic. These are all small things. These are very easy. If they are not, I make things easy and try to make it understandable for you. So that's all for today's session. Thank you. Bye-bye. Take care. Keep motivated. Keep learning.